Hello friends, welcome to my YouTube channel. Today's video is a dedicated masterclass of pelvic spaces with retroperitoneal anatomy. So as we all know, in cases like endometriosis or carcinoma cervix or carcinoma endometrium, we need to have retroperitoneal dissection, for which one should be well versed with retroperitoneal anatomy, ureteric tracing, different pelvic spaces, etc. So today's video is a dedicated masterclass about pelvic spaces. Just to remind you all, this video is entirely meant for educational and academic purposes. Efforts have been taken to maintain patients' privacy. So let's start with our case. First and foremost, always at the start of your laparoscopic surgery, reposit the bowel well and expose your field of dissection. So as you all can see, I have exposed my area of dissection. You can clearly see ureter crossing from lateral to medial side, and also I have exposed sacral promontory. So let's proceed with our retroperitoneal dissection. So there are multiple different approaches for retroperitoneal dissection. Two widely popular approaches are medial and lateral approach. Medial is also known as endometriotic approach, as it is widely used for performing endometriotic surgeries. Lateral approach is also called as oncological approach, because lateral approach is widely used in oncological surgeries for pelvic lymphadenectomies in cases like CA cervix or CA endometrium. So whichever approach you are comfortable with, you can proceed accordingly. This lateral and medial approaches are defined with relation to infundibulopelvic ligament. So let's first identify infundibulopelvic ligament and then proceed with our retroperitoneal dissection. So as you can see on the screen, I am using harmonic scalpel for retroperitoneal dissection. As I have already explained in all my other videos, harmonic is the best possible instrument for such delicate retroperitoneal or other endometriotic dissections. So as you can see on the screen, I have identified the infundibulopelvic ligament, and now I am proceeding ahead using medial approach of retroperitoneal dissection. So as you can see on the screen, I am giving a bold peritoneal cut on the medial side of infundibulopelvic ligament. You can clearly see ureteric peristalsis movement just below my peritoneal cut. After taking this bold peritoneal cut, now I'll lift the peritoneal edge and I will try to lateralize the ureter as much as possible. So there are few basic steps of ureteric dissection that one should always follow. First and foremost, you should be well versed with ureteric anatomy. After identifying the ureter, first step is to lateralize the ureter. Second step is to medialize the ureter and to identify different pelvic spaces. So while I lateralize and medialize the ureter, let's just briefly talk about different pelvic landmarks and also the ureteric anatomy. So when we talk about important pelvic landmarks, sacral promontory is the most important of all. The sacral promontory, in its literal sense, is the summit of the pelvis. Pathological conditions of the pelvis may reach the abdomen and beyond. However, their origin always lies at a level below the sacral promontory. So why I am saying that sacral promontory is important is because the common iliac vessels bifurcate into the internal and external iliac vessels at this particular level. The ureter, in its literal sense, travels from lateral to medial side over common iliac vessels at this particular point of sacral promontory. The superior hypogastric nerve plexus as a parasympathetic nerve plexus unites to form the left and right hypogastric nerves at this level. And last but not the least, the sacral promontory forms the initiation point for transperitoneal paraaortic lymph node dissection. So as you can see on the screen, I have lateralized the ureter and now I am medializing the ureter and I am trying to do a blunt dissection to identify a transverse vessel which is crossing over the ureter anteriorly. So as you all can see, this is a typical anatomy of water under the bridge where uterine artery crosses over the ureter anteriorly and uterine vein crosses over the ureter posteriorly, forming a Y-shaped fork of vessels through which ureter passes. So this is a very typical anatomy of water under the bridge formed by uterine artery, uterine vein and the ureter. So another important question that I face regularly when I am discussing this typical anatomy with my residents or even colleagues, that how to identify retroperitoneal anatomy of uterine artery, or how to be sure whether this is uterine artery and not any other structure. So it is an unsaid rule in laparoscopy while performing retroperitoneal dissection that dissection of tubular structures is done in a parallel direction to the long axis of the structure. So if you perform this type of parallel retroperitoneal dissection within ureter and external iliac vein, the first structure which is transverse and which will obstruct your longitudinal or parallel dissection will always be the uterine artery. So as you can see on the screen, I have identified the uterine artery and now I am trying to skeletonize the uterine artery so that I can ligate it at its origin. So as we all know, uterine artery is a branch of anterior division of internal iliac artery. So as we all know, internal iliac artery has anterior and posterior divisions. The anterior division of the internal iliac artery travels parallel to the ureter. The first branch of the anterior division is the uterine artery, after which the internal iliac artery branches again as the superior vesical artery at a plane higher than the uterine artery, and then it continues further as the obliterated hypogastric artery to the anterior abdominal wall. So after talking about internal iliac artery, ureter and uterine artery, now let's just come to our chief topic about the pelvic spaces. So there are multiple different pelvic spaces that have been identified and named. Two most important spaces out of all are paravesical and pararectal spaces. So as you can see on the screen, there is this horizontal pulsatile structure which is called as uterine artery. The space which you are able to see anterior to the uterine artery is a paravesical space. The space which is posterior to the uterine artery is also called as pararectal space. Pararectal space again is divided into medial and lateral pararectal space by the crossing ureter. So let's discuss every space in detail. So first and foremost, what is paravesical space? So the paravesical space is the retroperitoneal space that lies lateral to the urinary bladder and anterior and superior to the pararectal space. It is enclosed medially by the bladder, laterally by the pelvic walls and inferiorly by the uterine artery. As you can clearly see on the screen, the pararectal and paravesical space can mutually communicate with each other and also with the pre-vesical space. So the space which I'm showing or pointing on the screen is the paravesical space, and the tubular structure that is dividing paravesical space into medial and lateral is nothing but the obliterated hypogastric artery or the lateral umbilical ligament. So as you can see on the screen, After adequately skeletonizing the uterine artery, I have coagulated and cut the uterine artery at its origin. So that's the avascular paravesical space. If you can continue the dissection to its floor, it will always lead you to the levator ani muscle. So again, as you can see on the screen, I'm taking care of the ureteric dissection and its attachment to the peritoneal fold. So now let's just talk about pararectal space. The retroperitoneal space lying lateral to the rectum on either side is known as the pararectal space. Pararectal spaces take the shape of a curve of sacrum bone. The roof of the pararectal space comprises the posterior leaf of the broad ligament. Its medial borders are formed by the rectum, and laterally it is bound by the internal iliac artery. Cranially, the space terminates at the uterine artery and the levator ani forms its floor. The ureter, as I have just mentioned few minutes back, divides the pararectal space into the medial and lateral pararectal spaces. The medial pararectal space is known as the Okabayashi space, whereas the lateral pararectal space is known as the space of Latsuko. So as you can see on the screen, I am skeletonizing the anterior division of internal iliac artery. After giving uterine artery as its first branch, it gives superior vesical artery, and then it continues as obliterated hypogastric artery. So you can clearly see its branch, which is also called as superior vesical artery. So let's again discuss about the ureteric dissection. So as you can see, I have entirely dissected the ureter along its entire pelvic course. You should always understand why I talk so high about harmonic is because it has minimal lateral spread out of all the instruments, and especially in cases such as retroperitoneal dissections, when you are dissecting the ureter or any vessel, this lateral thermal spread plays a very vital role, because if your instrument has a large lateral spread, then you might end up in damaging the ureter or its blood supply indirectly through your lateral thermal spread mechanism. So before I end my video, let me show you the ureteric tunnel. So you can clearly see ureter is entering inside the ureteric tunnel at this particular point, which is about 1 to 1.5 centimeter lateral to the uterosacral insertion. So you can clearly see the tubular structure, which is on the left of ureter, is nothing but uterosacral ligament. And ureter is entering inside the ureteric tunnel, which is approximately 1 to 1.5 centimeter lateral to the uterosacral ligament. So I am almost done with my retroperitoneal space demonstration. And you can clearly see on the screen different spaces and retroperitoneal structures which I have marked. I hope this was very informative for you. Thank you.